Hi everyone, welcome to my channel. This is Dr. G. Maruthi Prasad Yadav, and in this session I would like to explain about the clutches and especially the cone clutch. So already in my previous videos I have presented regarding the single plate clutch. So I have explained the process to find the maximum torque that clutch can transmit under uniform pressure condition and uniform wear condition with single plate clutch. Now this time I have come out with cone clutch, means to find out the torque that it can transmit under two cases. One is uniform pressure condition, the other is uniform wear condition. Okay, let's begin. So just I have drawn the rough outline diagram how a cone clutch looks like. So here we can have a cone shaped part or surface which is connected to driver shaft, and whereas another surface of cone shape is connected to the driver shaft. It is not completely cone shape, it is a frustum of cone. So you can see this one, this is a sectional view where this surface, this part is connected to driver shaft and this part is connected to driver shaft. And what happens is these two parts or surface are kept together or make to be in contact with each other by applying axial force. So by applying axial force, what happens? This inner surface of this cone part, inner surface of this cone part and outer surface of this cone part get in contact with each other, and thereby it maintains the contact, and through which the driver shaft power can be transmitted to driven shaft, and that contact can be maintained by using the friction force between these two surfaces. So these two are coated with some friction material, some ferrodo or some any asbestos material, so that it can maintain the contact. And the torque it can be transmitted depends upon the friction, maximum friction force. Means the maximum friction force, the force developed, the tangential force need to be transmitted. If it exceeds the friction force, then obviously slipping takes place. In other words, we can say that if the maximum torque which need to transmit is less than the torque which can be transmitted with the help of that friction force, then obviously the torque can be transmitted or power can be transmitted from driver shaft to the driven shaft without any loss, without any slipping. So that we have to find out now, the maximum torque which this cone clutch can transmit from driver shaft to driven shaft. Okay, let's get into the derivation part or the process of finding the torque value. Okay, let's begin. Now have a look at this one. So as already explained that the two conical surfaces, but the frustum of conical surfaces are in contact, which result in transmission of power by maintaining the contact by using the frictional force. Now let us consider only one part, means either a driven part or a driver part. So it will be like this. This is the frustum surface. So let us consider the R2 is the minimum radius from here to here. Okay, and this end from here to this maximum radius R1. And you can see the side view and front view here. So when we see from this side, we can see this circle with radius of R2. R2 and this radius maximum one is of R1. Okay, now let us find out the torque it can transmit. So instead of taking the complete area which is under friction, the area which is under friction is the surface of the frustum of cone, means this surface entirely. Okay, but we are not taking the entire area, we have to take only element ring, and we find out the torque which that element ring area can transmit, and integrating it by applying the minimum and maximum limits, we can find out the maximum torque that the whole area which is in contact can transmit. Okay, so I have considered the element ring. This is the element ring area I have considered throughout the circumference of this frustum surface, and where we have considered this element ring at a radius of R, means from here to here, this R, and whereas you can see this one is, this is the first term, it is an increased tapered one. So obviously radius at this and this is different. So we got here some thickness, that is we are taken as dr. And if you take this element ring width along this taper surface, we are taking it as a dl. And we can take this complete width of the surface will be taken as b. So now here r1 is the minimum radius of that frustum of cone, r1 is the maximum radius of the area which is in contact or which is under friction, and r is the radius of the element ring what we considered, and dr is the thickness of this element ring in this direction, the transverse direction, not along the axial direction, along the transverse direction. And thickness of element ring along this taper surface is dl, and b is the total length of this taper surface or frustum of the cone, or total width or cone width or face width, clutch width. Okay, so let's begin now. Now we have to consider first of all the area of the element ring. So area of the element ring is this circumference completely 2 pi r into thickness. Okay, so it becomes 2 pi r into dl. Now dl is the length along this taper surface. This dl we have to take in terms of radius, so that's why have a look at this one. So let's take alpha is the angle, semicone angle. Okay, angle. So if you observe carefully here, this one, this part I'll observe here, this one, this part I'll draw separately. This triangle I have drawn, this part I have drawn separately, and this is dl, this is alpha angle, this is dr. So from this we can get sin alpha is equal to dr by dl, sin alpha equals to dr by dl. From that dl equals to So sin alpha is equal to dr by dl. From that dl is equal to dr by sin alpha. Nothing but dr by sin alpha is nothing but dr into cosecant alpha. Substitute this one here. So this is the area of element ring what we considered. Now here onwards we have to proceed considering two cases. One is uniform pressure condition, the other is uniform wear condition. Why to consider these two conditions? Already I have explained in my previous videos. You can watch those videos, then you will get the clarity regarding those two conditions to be considered. One is uniform pressure condition, the other is uniform wear condition. Let me start with uniform pressure condition. So let us start with uniform pressure condition. So now all of CR actually already explained that one cone surface will be like this, the frustum of cone, the other will be like this, it get in contact with this one. So that it may, when this rotates, obviously because of contact here it can hold this one. If this is the driver shaft connected to the engine, if this is the driven shaft, then it can maintain the contact like this. So because of the friction between these two surfaces, this driver component can make this driven component to rotate along with it. So because of the friction here, because of the friction here. So what happens when these two are pressed together here at this taper surface where it is in contact, here the pressure develops, here the pressure develops in this direction normal to the taper surface. Means all of you have a look at this one. So this is P suffix N. This is P suffix N means the normal pressure. Where from the normal pressure has been developed? Because of this contact. When these two are pressed together, here this one pushes this one and this one pushes this direction. Means a normal pressure develops here. That we have to consider. And because of this normal pressure is acting along this tapered surface. Now because of this normal pressure, a normal load develops. You can take in terms of pressure or load or force. When pressure is there, force will be there. Force by area is nothing but pressure. Means this is the force acting per unit area. If you take the total force, it is a load or force Wn. So let Wn is the normal force. Pressure P suffix N is the normal pressure. Now we are considering only this element ring. So for this element ring, what is the normal force developed? Delta suffix Wn. This is the normal force on that element ring. If you take the total area, then it is Wn. So this is equals to pressure into area. Pressure is called force by area. Force is called pressure into area. Pressure into area. Area this one. Okay, substituting this one here, we got this one. Next, this force is acting in this direction. So I will draw here, see here. So here the force is developed. Only for this element ring, this shaded portion, this one. Now we can resolve this one left and upward. Horizontal component is left side, vertical component is upward. Whereas this angle is, so we can find out this one. All of here. When you extend this one, obviously this is alpha. This is 90 minus alpha. From this, this is alpha. So when this is alpha, delta W1 cos alpha is vertical component. Delta W1 sin alpha is the horizontal component. So let us find out the force developed here. This is W. Because this part is pushed toward this one. So how much force is developed axially? That we are taking as W. In this direction, Wn. Now we have to consider the horizontal component of this one. Then this it is nothing but delta W. It's a horizontal component or horizontal force of acting on that element ring portion. That is equals to, from this one, as I said, delta W1 cos is vertical upward, delta W1 sin is left side. Sin alpha. Now delta W1 is this one. Substituting this one here, so cosecant alpha, sin alpha will get cancelled. Okay, so now this is the axial force acting on that element ring. Now we, as I said, W is the total axial force acting on the entire area. How can we can find out? Miss, by integrating this one. W equals to integration of delta W. What is the minimum and maximum limit? Minimum limit is R2, maximum limit is R1. So this is equals to, substitute this one here. So here Pn 2 pi is constant, we can take outside, where the remaining is integration of r dr, where integration of r dr is nothing but r square by 2. So applying the limits. So a 2 get cancel. Okay. So from this, W is equal to Pn pi R1 square minus R2 square. So keeping Pn towards one side and bringing all the remaining terms towards the other side. So this is the normal force. This is the total, sorry, this is the total normal pressure developed on that tapered surface, the frustum of cone area which is under friction. So let us find out the friction force developed there. So let us consider F suffix R is the friction force developed only for that ring portion. That is equals to, we all know that constant of friction is equal to F by R, friction force by normal reaction. Therefore friction force is equal to mu into, so mu is the coefficient of friction into normal reaction. And therefore, here normal reaction is, as I said that, here this is the pressure, nothing but here itself is, delta W1. So delta W1 is acting here like this, allows here, delta W1 is acting like this. So reaction will be opposite exactly. And we all know that, normal reaction is exactly opposite to the external force developed, which is equal in magnitude and exactly opposite direction. So from that, this delta W1 is equal to normal reaction. So normal reaction Rn equals to delta W1. So substituting this one here, this one delta W1 here, this is the delta W1, mu into Pn cosecant alpha. So now you have the friction force. Now T suffix R, that is the term which can be transmitted because of only this friction force, because of that element ring area, equals to friction force into radius. We all know that torque is equal to tangential force into radius. So from that, looking at this one, so therefore mu Pn 2 pi r cosecant alpha, substituting this one here, into r. So into r means we can take this r square here. So mu Pn 2 pi r square dr cosecant alpha. Okay, now we have to find out the total torque which it can transmit conjuring the entire area. That we can find out by integrating this one, because this is for element ring. Integrating it, we'll get the total torque. And what is the minimum maximum limit is? Minimum limit is R2, maximum is R1. So integration of R1, this one we have to substitute here, mu here, mu Pn 2 pi cosecant alpha. These are constants, we can take it outside, and remaining is integration of R square dr, whereas R square dr integration is becomes R cube by 3. So from that, so from this, substituting these limits, so mu Pn 2 pi cosecant alpha R1 cube minus R2 cube by 3. So this is the total torque. And here we know that P is the normal pressure, which we got from here. PN is equal to W by pi into R1 square minus R2 square. Substitute this one here, then torque will become mu. This PN is nothing but W by into 2 pi cosecant alpha . So from this pi get cancelled. So remaining thing, writing in a simplified form, so therefore finally the maximum torque a cone clutch can transmit is equals to 2 by 3 mu w cosecant alpha r1 cube minus r2 cube by r1 square minus r2 square. This is under uniform pressure condition. So this is all about the cone clutch under uniform pressure condition, and we got the finally the torque which it can transmit. Okay, thank you for watching.